Fabulous. All right. So as we dive into farm, it does not mean farming, like I'm a farmer and I'm going to go out to the fields, which is what I originally thought that it meant. So I originally thought it was like, oh, well, you go out, you know, you sprinkle water on them and eventually it grows into something. That's why they call it a farm. And then I was corrected a couple of years ago, and farm stands for frequent area of repetitive marketing. It's an acronym. So frequent area of repetitive marketing, super important, because that's how we want to approach our farm, is we want to make sure we're frequently and repetitively marketing that area. Now, I would venture to say that you should be working to prospect your farm and make it so you want to be prospecting based and marketing enhanced, and you want that same approach to your farm. And what that means is that in your farm, you want to get face-to-face with people as often as possible. Now, if you're like, Amy, how would I even start this? What would I do? There's a couple different kinds of farms. One is a demographic farm. This is not my favorite form of farming, but you could do a demographic farm. That would be where you join in and find like all renters in a certain neighborhood, and you're targeting those renters to move up to, well, it doesn't even have to be a certain neighborhood. It could be all of Vacaville or all of Sassoon or whatever area you've chosen. It could be all renters, and that's who you're targeting. It could be people that maybe are move down buyers, right? It could be, you know, whatever. So a demographic farm would be based on the people living in the home or the situation in the home, versus what my favorite would be a geographic farm, which would be a certain neighborhood or location. We don't eliminate anyone. So those are the two types of farms. We got a demographic farm or a geographic farm. I prefer the geographic farm. I actually would encourage you to look at your own neighborhood, only because I feel like you have a leg in on your own neighborhood, where you can say, hey, I'm your neighbor. I'm the expert in the neighborhood. Not only that, but I drive by your house on a daily basis, right? Like, you are truly the neighborhood expert and you have a vested interest in that neighborhood. That being said, you don't have to do your own neighborhood. Sometimes your own neighborhood maybe is not a desirable area where you want to do business. Maybe there's already somebody farming your neighborhood that you're aware of that is there on a regular basis, knocking on doors and has the majority of the market share. So when we choose our farm, we want to choose, your farm should be ultimately, you should grow it to about 400 homes is what's considered an average farm size. I highly recommend starting in a neighborhood that has the potential for 400 homes, but where you're going to start with maybe 100 homes. We want something small and manageable for the first couple of months, and then we'll continue to grow it and step it up after that. And the reason I say that is that if you start with 400 homes, you're going to go door knock 400 homes on a monthly basis. That's quite the time commitment. It takes a lot of energy and effort, and you might feel overwhelmed and you might just only do it once if we start with 400. But if we start with 100 and we do that for a quarter, and then the second quarter, we add another 100 homes, and then the third quarter, we add another 100 homes. And then by the end of the year, we're at 400 homes. That would be a great way to manage it, to make sure you're consistent in marketing the homes that you've started with, those first 100 homes. Once you're consistent in that for 3 or 4 months, now we're going to add that second 100 homes. Okay, so just some little tips there. Don't start with an area that's overwhelming. Generally speaking, when you look at a farm, you want somewhere around a 5 to 7% turnover rate, which is the rate at which homes are selling. Now, that's just the general statistics and guidelines. If you talk with your title company, if you have relationships with a title company, talk with your title company, and you give them the neighborhood, they'll be able to tell you what the turnover rate is for that neighborhood. If you don't have a relationship with a title company, now's a good time to start talking with some different title reps and figure out who your favorite title company is and who you want to use. All of them are fabulous and amazing in Vacaville. It just is who you're most comfortable with, who has the best service, right? Who's getting back to you, who has the best tools. You know, you want to make sure that it's a mutually beneficial relationship when you choose a title company. And they'll be able to tell you that turnover rate. Now, that being said, I don't bank my farm on turnover rate. And the reason that I don't is that some neighborhoods maybe had a really high turnover 3 or 4 years ago, and now they've kind of leveled out and they haven't had much turnover for a couple of years. They may be getting ready to have a solid turnover again. And so I don't always limit myself based on turnover rate. However, I do always take that into consideration when choosing a farm. The other thing that you want to note is that you want to make sure that you, I lost my train of thought there. I don't remember where I was headed with that, but choose a farm, turnover rates. Oh, choose a farm in an area where you want to do business. So if your neighborhood isn't where you want to do business, because maybe the house price point is lower, maybe it's a super high luxury neighborhood and you're like, man, I just don't want to embark on this neighborhood. I'd rather have one that has more homes. Maybe you live out in the country, so knocking on doors would be really difficult because it's a half mile between each driveway. You know, whatever that is, you're not limited to your neighborhood or any neighborhood, but you want to pick one that has an area that you want to do business in. Okay, you want to pull the market stats for that neighborhood. So the same way that we got on yesterday onto Barry's and we pulled like a little neighborhood search on there, you could do the same thing, go back for sold listings over the last year and look and see if anybody has the primary market share for that neighborhood. Now, if there's only been 2 sales from that neighborhood, one person having both those sales isn't a primary share, but you just want to make sure that, you know, out of the sales, there's not one agent that seems to have the market share of that neighborhood. If there is one agent, then I would probably select a different area or a different neighborhood because that one's probably already being effectively farmed. Okay, most of our neighborhoods in Vacaville are not being effectively farmed. The other way to find out if something's being farmed is select your neighborhood, get an idea of where you want to go, and then go pound pavement, go knock doors, have conversations with people, introduce yourself, and ask if they've had any other real estate agents frequently coming by their home to keep them updated of what's going on in the market. That's a really good way to find a pulse of a neighborhood if somebody else is knocking on doors. Okay. Now, a farm isn't just knocking on doors, but it does entail that. Again, I recommend getting in front of people and having conversations. So you could like run door to door and drop stuff off on their doorstep. And you're not going to have as many conversations as if you actually knock on their doors. Your first interaction with your farm, you want to be an introduction. I usually bring something with me when I go to my farm, something of value. So if my first visit was an introduction, I'm probably going to bring a piece of paper that introduces me as a real estate agent, as the local expert in that specific area. If that is my neighborhood, I may actually say that, hey, I'm your neighbor. I live right around the corner on, you know, North Park or whatever the street is that you live on. You may not want to identify your exact house, but maybe your general area, just so you back up the claim that you're actually a neighbor and you want to do an introduction. Okay. You want to let them know that you're going to come by on a regular basis and keep them up to date with what's going on in the neighborhood and the area. And that maybe, you know, depending on how you decide to structure your farm based on our conversation today, you may want to state that you're going to be doing some fun activities for the neighborhood or some you like to give back to the community. So you'll be doing some fun drives or whatever that would be. Just kind of introduce yourself in that introductory visit with an introductory letter that you can leave behind with them if you have a conversation. And if you don't get them, I would leave the letter behind. Now, on one side, I'd probably have the introductory letter. On the other side, I'd probably go ahead and have like a market update on there, right? What's available in that neighborhood? What's for sale? What's sold in the past couple of months? What's in contract or pending? And I would really put probably in contract because most people don't understand like contingent or pending. They're like, I don't understand what that is. But if you put it's under contract, they usually understand that. So I would keep them up to date of the market so that they have a little snapshot of what you're doing. Now, I think on Real Scout, you could pull up the neighborhood and you can actually print that summary that Real Scout gives you, which we looked at yesterday. Which would be a good way to just quickly pull the market stats, showing you kind of what's going on with the market, or you could go into Barry's and pull it that way and then put it in a really cute format. You've got one design at your fingertips through your one login, and one design has some great like postcards or letters or whatnot that you can go in there and design and lay out and tweak really easily in order to have something to print up to take with you. So that would be my first visit to my farm. My goal would be with my farm would be to knock on doors once a month, every month. Okay. So you're going to knock on those doors 12 times a month. I'm always going to have something of value with me, and I'm always going to leave something behind if they don't answer their door. My favorite thing to leave behind is a postcard versus a piece of paper. It just is a little sturdier and holds up a little bit better. And so it slides underneath the doormat really easily, or right in the side of the door, versus a piece of paper. If it's a little wet outside and it gets a drop of water on it, it becomes really flimsy and not as sturdy, and the ink blurs versus a postcard. Postcards don't have to be super expensive. You can order them through One Design has postcards that you can have shipped to you. Canva now, you can go in there and design stuff and print it up and they'll send it to you. So you need to plan in advance. If my goal is to walk the neighborhood the second week of every month, then probably 2 weeks before that, I need to have on my calendar to go in there and design something to bring with me. What are you going to bring with you? Right? So what kind of materials would you want to bring to your farm? Number one, I always would have a market update. People really like that. It gets received really well. They like to be kept up to date of what properties actually sold for, what's on the market, what's coming on the market, what the square footage is, because they always want to compare it to their properties. In addition to that, I would bring something else. So oftentimes when we did our farm, we would have the market update on the back of the postcard, and on the front of the postcard, we would have something fun, either that we were hosting in that neighborhood or like activities and events coming up in Vacaville for the season. Like, it's the Christmas season right now, so there's Christmas tree farms. So maybe in the beginning of December, you may want to, or at the like mid-November, you may want to make a list of all of the Christmas tree farms, right? Where can you go get a Christmas tree in Solano County or in Vacaville or in Fairfield, right? Make a list of that. Or where are the pumpkin patches? Right? And what are some of the bonus points? Because some people don't know, like, about Grandpa's Barn or whatever it is, where you can go pet animals, or about Bobby Dazzlers, where they have a fun little roller coaster ride, right? So it's a good thing to point those things out and make people aware of those activities and events. It may be if you're near like a high school that, and, you know, like if you're on the north side of Vacaville, then you've got Vacaville High School. So maybe you want to come August, send out the schedule for the high school home varsity games or the high school home baseball games so that people can go support the local students. You may want to just find fun events, like summer's coming up. What kind of events does the city of Vacaville offer for people to do? Like, you know, discounted bowling or discounted or free ice skating, depending on the temperature. Is the theater doing the discounted movies on Tuesday? So just find some fun events or fun things to do that you can promote that make it kind of fun and exciting. So that would be one thing you could do on the front. The other thing that you, and there's no wrong or right way to do this. So you can do whatever you want. I'm just giving you some ideas. Some other things you could do is you could partner with local businesses. And then each month, maybe you bring a coupon by on the front that's for, you know, maybe you partner with an Italian food restaurant. Number one, it's a good partnership for that Italian food restaurant. You're like, hey, I market a neighborhood of 400 people, or I market a neighborhood of, I'm at 100 people, and I'm going to pass this coupon out to all 100 homes, which is going to grow your business and help me with mine as well, right? We want to make it a mutually beneficial relationship and get them to give a coupon for like a free appetizer or a free, you know, dessert for the table or whatever it might be. And then you can work with them on the logos and design and put that on the front. So now you've got something of value that you can offer people. You're partnering with local businesses, so you're growing your business to business network that we'll talk about later through the lead gen process. So that could be a really cool way to do it. If you maybe partnered with three businesses or something to that effect, then you can make it like for a whole quarter that coupon's good. Maybe make it like a business card size with your information on one side, the other business's information on the other with a coupon on there. And maybe it's good every time they go to that business for like 3 months or something like that. So something they're going to keep with them, stick in their wallet and have with them on a regular basis. That's our goal, is to get something that they can keep. In addition to that, you may be like, man, I really like to give back to the community. Okay, well, let's have some drives or do some fun stuff in our neighborhoods, right? So in our farms, let's, it's December. So maybe we need to do a coat drive for the kids at school. And so, you know, you door knock on the second week of January, you have a little link where they can register that they'll have coats to pick up. And then on a certain day towards the end of the month, you drive around and pick up all of those coats. Or maybe they can drop them off at the office. Or maybe if you live in that neighborhood, they can drop them off on your doorstep, right? And you could find something to do a fun charitable drive every month of the year if you wanted to, if you wanted to operate that way, which would be fun. You could also do activities and events that you could promote on those postcards as well. You could do like a paper shredding event where you have a paper shredding company come out to the neighborhood, and everybody on that day can bring all of their sensitive paperwork to get shredded. You could bring a dumpster to the neighborhood and have everybody can drop off their big items in the dumpster. You could do a neighborhood garage sale. You could do a national night out inside that, hosted at that park. We actually did that one time. It was quite fun, and we made it like a potluck. So all the neighbors brought something to share and eat, and then the police came and the fire trucks and the garbage trucks, and it was super fun. So you can do activities and events. I had somebody did a 4th of July bike parade. You could do like an animal parade. So you could do all sorts of fun activities and events on a regular basis. And I highly recommend that in your farm. Your goal is to get out there to provide them value in their lives, something that's going to bring them something, in addition to make that known that you're a local agent and you're the area expert. So I recommend at least once a quarter doing some sort of activity or event. You could do we kind of talked about this yesterday with your sphere of influence. You could do it inside your farm as well. You could do like a pumpkin carving contest. You don't have to provide the pumpkins. It's October. Everybody's carving pumpkins anyways. Tell them to send a picture to you of their pumpkins, and you can do a pumpkin carving contest, right? You could start, and it would be a good idea too, if you have a farm in a specific neighborhood, to start a Facebook page or a social media group for that neighborhood, and then invite people to join it and keep them up to date about what's going on, what drives, what events, what activities, the market stats inside that group as well. That would be a really great way to maintain and control the verbiage and reiterate that you're a market expert. Now, if I were to start a group in a neighborhood, I would not invite other agents to join that group. I would be the only real estate agent in that group. If one of those neighbors is a real estate agent, I may not let them in my group, right? Because I want to control the narrative, and I want to be the go-to agent for that group. So just something to keep in mind there. But I definitely would start a social media page for that, as well as, next door has the neighborhoods already defined and drawn out, and they already have a way to communicate with each other inside the neighborhood. You can make sure that you find the houses on there. You can see what houses have are part of next door and which aren't. So you could go and try to get the ones that haven't joined to join. And you can also sponsor neighborhoods inside next door. It's like $60 a month, and it allows you to promote and advertise and do all sorts of things inside of next door. So just some fun ideas there of ways that you can get plugged in a little deeper, create more of a community, and create more of a value field. Does anybody have any questions so far?
I do. Can you hear
me? Yep.
Okay. Thank you for sharing this. This is great. So it's different for everyone, but can you help us understand like a good budget to kind of plan for monthly to make to be effective?
Yeah, absolutely. I think you could spend very little money on a monthly basis and be super effective. I would, like I said, I would always make sure I have like a postcard or something to bring with me that has the information that I'm going to talk to them about if I have an interaction to leave behind. And really, like if you're starting with a farm of 400 and you're really going to start with just that 100 homes and be consistent with those 100 homes, I don't know how much, I don't remember what Canva's printing price was, and I don't know what One Design's printing price was, but you should be able to print those postcards for about 75 cents max per business or per postcard. Or if you were going to be, you could do like a black and white letter and keep it really cheap and use your free copies at the office to keep your costs really low. Getting into your farm, I always say that you should lead with revenue. And so you don't want to be spending a ton of money and then not having money come in. So my goal would be, or my recommendation would be, to keep costs low. And then as you begin to grow your farm, you start having transactions inside of that farm, then you can increase your budget. But I would say at the beginning, you don't want to be spending more than like $100 a month on your farm. And I would say that's the max. If you don't have money coming in, you could tone it down a little bit. And like I said, use those free copies at the office and just do it on a piece of paper. Totally appropriate to do that, right? It's all about building. Yeah, absolutely. So, and then, you know, a lot of the events, like if you did a garage sale, it doesn't have to be, it's super expensive, or you don't, or we did the garage sale and I don't even think we spent, well, we did spend about $100 on it because we ordered a bunch of signs. So we put all the signs up, but then we really just had people register with kind of some of their main things that they were selling. We had maps at each table that we just printed at the office, so it was free. We got little goodie bags where most of the stuff was donated from other vendors and reps from title companies and some of the stuff was title company and then like home warranty, home inspections, right? We had stuff donated from them, created little goodie bags for each of our homes that were hosting the garage sales. And so we just made it super fun and it wasn't an expensive endeavor either. Same thing with like the National Night Out, like no money out of pocket to have a potluck at the park and register it for the National Night Out so that all of the first responders and everybody come by and visit with all their vehicles and make it fun for the kids. So you can do it super cheap. It doesn't have to be super expensive. As you grow and have transactions, you may want to step it up a little bit and offer more things, right? So I would say keep it pretty simple at the beginning for sure. As I mentioned, you want to kind of start small and then earn the right to add to it. You want to make sure that neighborhood has the ability to grow into a larger farm, but we want to just start with like the first 100 homes. Be consistent in that for the first quarter. Once you're consistent, you've kind of earned the right to grow it to the next 100. And then once you're consistent with those 200 homes, then you've earned the right to grow it to 300. So don't overwhelm yourself at the beginning. It also helps you to keep costs low by starting smaller. As far as other activities, again, we're aiming to be the market expert or the neighborhood expert in that area. So if I'm going to host an open house and I see another agent in our office has a listing in my farm, you better bet that I'm going to knock on Anastasia's door. Well, I'm really going to call her up and be like, hey, can I host the open houses in your listing over there? I would love to do that for you, right? That's going to be my first place that I'm going to look for open houses because I want my signs there. I want my name in that neighborhood. I just want to continue to be prospecting based and marketing enhanced. I want those people to see my name everywhere in that neighborhood. Okay. Your farm is going to have a slower rate of return in the beginning than other forms of lead generation. Okay. An open house, we could walk into host an open house this weekend. My goal would be to walk away with one solid lead that's going to turn into a transaction. Whereas my first time knocking my farm, I may not get anybody that's looking to buy, sell, or has anybody looking to move to that neighborhood, right? So we're looking for people buying or selling homes in our farm, as well as people that there are cheerleaders for that neighborhood. And so maybe they know people that want to move to that neighborhood. We want to make sure we get that information as well. And so it may be a little bit longer. Oftentimes, to build rapport inside a neighborhood for a farm, it's going to take 12 to 18 months to see a significant return on your investment. You might get one or two here, and you should get one or two here. But in order to continue branding yourself and then to see your name over and over and you to create that consistency through that farm, it's going to take 12 to 18 months for you to kind of become really, truly that neighborhood agent. And it really does take you being consistent in your efforts. Any other questions? Nothing? Everybody's happy? If you go to the title company too, the title company should be able to provide you a list with all of the homeowners in that neighborhood or all the homeowners, and it'll show you whether they're a owner occupied home or a non-owner occupied home. So whether it's a tenant occupied property or not. Old Republic Title Company has a fabulous app. They actually have a walking farm app where you can go in there, you can draw your exact farm in the neighborhood, you can save it. And then it gives you the ability, as you're walking that farm, you can select how you're going to walk it, in what order. It puts all the homes in order. And then each one that you visit, it allows you to click on that home to make any notes, to note whether they answered the door, whether you talked to them, whether they weren't home, whether they said, don't ever come back by my door again. You know, whatever that might be, you can make those notes in there, and then you can export it into a Excel spreadsheet or whatnot so that you have that information, and you can pull that farm up again each time you go back and pull up each house. So you have the notes from the last time. So maybe you made a note that somebody was getting ready to go on vacation to Hawaii. Then the next time you walk in the door, you could ask, hey, how was that vacation? Right? Did you enjoy your time in Hawaii, or whatever that would be? You'd have those notes right at your fingertips. You know whether you talked to that person last time or you didn't talk to that person. So it's a really great way to track, just like you would any other phone call or anything else.
Can I ask you a question?
Absolutely.
What's your opinion on knocking on doors to add value to all the doors that say no soliciting? And I'm curious because I went door knocking and I feel like 70% of the doors had that sign on there. And I didn't knock. I just left something at the door.
Well, we're not soliciting. We're just offering them value. We're bringing them the market stats. We're bringing them the, you know, whatever's going on in the neighborhood. And so I would absolutely knock on a door that says no soliciting. And if somebody says, can't you see the sign? I'd be like, oh, I'm not really selling anything. I'm just coming by to keep you updated of what's going on in the market and what's going on in this neighborhood. Right?
Perfect. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. You also don't have to bypass doors that are for sale either. It's not a violation, an ethics violation, for you to knock on doors that are for sale, because you're marketing the entire neighborhood equally. If you were just targeting homes that were for sale, trying to gain their business, then that would be an ethics violation. But as long as they're part of your regular farm and you're door knocking all the doors in that area, you could knock the ones that have for sale signs too.
Thank you for that. I have not been knocking on no soliciting doors for that exact reason.
Yeah, absolutely. Don't count anybody out. And if somebody tells me never to come back again, I'm still going to sneak up on their porch. If they're kind of hostile, I'm going to still sneak up on their porch the next time I come by and leave my flyer on their doorstep, although I may not knock on their door. Right? So I'm still going to drip on them on a regular basis and try to interact with them and gain their respect, but I may not aggressively knock on their door each month.
Do you have any opinion on good times, or it's like any time?
Any time is a good time to door knock. I highly recommend doing it in the morning because you're more likely to do it, right? So if we set up our things that we don't like doing first thing, you know, I wouldn't, you know, go knock on doors at 7 a.m. I'd probably wait till like 9 or 10 to start knocking on doors, especially if it's a weekend. But there's no good days or times. The only good day or time is the time that you're actually going to do it. So don't count any time out. There's lots of people that are home on random days that aren't home on the weekends or aren't home in the evenings. And so you're going to catch people at different times, different people. So there's no bad time to knock on a door. In the evenings, just so everybody knows, I usually stop door knocking by the time it's getting dark. I don't want to be knocking on doors after it's dark. And I know that like in the wintertime, that kind of limits you as far as timing goes because it's darker earlier. And in the summertime, I would not knock on doors at 9:30 if it was still light. I probably cut that off around 7. Okay.
I did door knocking on a Sunday morning, and it was great because I got to talk to a lot of people because everyone was home.
Yeah, right. A lot of people are home, but then the people that go to church aren't home that you might catch home on, you know, Monday or Tuesday or Saturday. So you're always going to catch different people. So you could change it up throughout the week too.
Hey, Amy, I have a question.
Yeah.
So I did a coat drive for my farm, mm-hmm. and I want to give like a little something to, you know, say thank you. Should I leave my business card in like a thank you note or just the thank you card?
I would leave your card with it as well. You know, thank you card or note or whatever that just says, you know, thank you so much for helping contribute to the coat drive. You know, whatever that might be. I would absolutely leave my card.
Okay. Thank you.
And if you do a coat drive or something like that, it's a good idea maybe the next month to give a report. Like we collected 27 coats, right? Or whatever that might be so that people know that, oh my gosh, like I totally missed that. And other people participated, right? FOMO, fear, mm-hmm. physical, like no,
that's a good idea.
Any other questions pertaining to a farm? It's going to be a little scary and intimidating the first time you go to knock on doors. So if you haven't knocked on doors before, it's okay if the first month you're like, oh, my name is Amy and I'm an agent. I'm going to keep you updated on it. And then you turn around and run away. It's all right. You can redeem yourself next month. You'll become more and more comfortable with it. The more doors that you don't get yelled at and turned away, which I found that people, once they found out you weren't like a solar dealer, that they're really receptive to being kept up to date of what's going on in the neighborhood and area. We created good friends inside of our farm and people that actually looked forward to us coming by on a monthly basis. All righty. If nobody has any other questions, then we're going to wrap up for the morning.
I have one question. Did I missed yesterday, but it sounds like you guys went through how to find the statistics. Was that one recorded?
Yeah. So yesterday was recorded. We talked about your sphere of influence and marketing to those people as well. And so that was recorded. And I'm not sure if it's been edited yet and posted. It may get posted next week. When we have it, it'll go into the Facebook group of the Foxhole, as well as if you subscribe to my YouTube channel, you'll be kept up to date of what gets added onto that channel because we'll add it there as well. Well, fabulous. Tomorrow's Saturday, so I won't see you tomorrow at 8 a.m., but I'll see you Monday at 8 a.m. when we continue our Legion series through the end of the year. So I'm looking forward to seeing you guys. Thanks everyone for jumping on today. I appreciate it. If you have any questions or anything after we get off this call, feel free to reach out.
Thank you, Amy. I appreciate you.
Thanks, yeah. Amy. This was great. Thank you. And a mangle in the jingling feet. That's the jingle bell. That's the jingle bell. That's the jingle bell.